two blocks away from here. So we are so excited to get started with tonight's event, but before we truly get into it, I just have a few housekeeping notes to get out of the way. First off, I want to give a huge thank you to First Unitarian for allowing us to use this gorgeous space tonight. If you need to use a restroom at any point, there are restrooms located both downstairs and upstairs towards my left side of the sanctuary, your right side. I know many of you picked up a copy of Tom Lane when you purchased your ticket, but in case you didn't, we have plenty of additional copies available for purchase at the table where you checked in. All of the copies of Tom Lane, along with copies of The Dutch House and These Precious Days, have been pre-signed by Anne, but due to personal reasons, there will not be a personalization line afterwards. And lastly, if you're joining us virtually on the YouTube live stream, you can purchase a copy of Tom Lane by clicking the link in the live stream description. Okay, let's get into this. Tonight, it is my privilege to introduce Anne Patchett and Emma Straub, who join us to celebrate the launch of Anne's newest novel, Tom Lane.
And it was at the Elkhorn. 1950s sort of ball gown. There was a lot of sequins and beads, and it was for some reason, I was doing it for some, I don't remember who I was interviewing people for, but yeah, it was a lot.
But you made a really positive and large impression, and after that, I always knew who you were. But back to the notes thing. So really, everything I know about having a career, Al Morganis taught me. And one of the things that he said was, whenever someone writes to you, and please God, don't write to me.
Board of Tourism pay
because
it's the most amazing thing.
we were talking about our fear of pear trees. Don't mess with them, guys. They are fierce.
I love that. I love that so much because I feel like it shows you just all the questions you never know to ask. Like all of the things that you wouldn't think to research that just happen. Like the knowledge that you get from being in a place and from growing up in a certain corner of the world.
Right. And yet, so this was the most beautiful thing that's happened to me on book tour. When I was doing book tour in Michigan towards the beginning, and let me tell you, this book is doing super well in Michigan. Has a bag that is closed. let us assume there are books in the bag. And he says, did you like it? And she says, well, you know, I'll tell you. I like the first 3/4 of it a lot. But I thought the ending was terrible. I'm just being honest. I thought the ending was terrible. And I did like it up until a certain point. And he said, do you think I should read it? And he said, and she said, no, no. And you know, it's fine. It's just the ending really dropped off. And then he says, well, I've read all of her other books, and I love her. I love her so much. And she owns that bookstore in Nashville.
Garden. And I read that and I was thinking about then you, the reader, you learn the whole story, but then you also learn things that she does not tell her daughters. And I just, like, I mean, that's part of why this book feels so, so well constructed to me. So I just want to ask about that, like, about making choices about what to tell, what not to tell, what to tell the reader, but not the children.
So nobody tells everything to everybody. I mean, it's not lying. I've had a lot of conversations about the difference between secret and private. And there's a way in which I feel like what Laura doesn't tell her daughters is private. There's no shame. She's not being deceptive in any way, but there are things you don't tell other people. And if you have an event, you are gonna tell one, you're gonna tell it to your sister one way, you're gonna tell it to your friend one way, you're gonna tell it to the cop on the scene one way, or the doctor in the ER one way, your husband one way. And you're not lying in any of those occasions, but we all craft stories to fit the audience. This is something that I say to my husband all the time. Know your audience. So he loves to meet people on the street in our neighborhood and meet them. And he's charming and he's the friendliest person in the world. But every now and then he captures a young couple who have two babies in a stroller and the babies are screaming and he's still talking and I'm like, know your audience. You gotta pay attention. So you tailor what you tell to fit your audience, if you know what you're doing at all. So it seems like the most natural thing in the world. Laura is telling the truth to herself, or not even the truth, the full story to herself, and we are her conscience. But she's not gonna tell the daughters everything, and she tells them that. You know, I'm okay, this is about a hot affair, and I am not going to tell you about the sex. Because you don't want your mother, even if you want your mother to tell you about the hot affair, you do not want to hear about the sex. You want to hear about the sex, but you don't want your mother to be in that scene. And there's also that feeling that it's very hard, even when we're super close to our parents and we're grown up, to understand that our parents were people before we came along. And we all really, no matter how much intellectually we know otherwise, we believe that the story started at the moment that we came onto the stage. And that's part of it too. Yeah.
Well, in story, like the idea of storytelling in this book is so rich because it's a story and a story and a story and a story. And you get, you know, Laura, you get her meeting our town as a teenager, and you get the story of her relationship with that part, you know, over the course of her life, and you get all of these repeated names that come back. I don't know, I just thought that, like, the layers of storytelling stories within the stories was just magnificent.
And you can't just say, I feel like you did that same thing in your last novel, that you're going back, which I love, but you're going back and you're seeing different versions of things that you know, and you're opening up a conversation. In fact, maybe I plagiarized this. Did I read your novel before I started my novel? I hadn't thought about this. Maybe
let's just assume that she did.
Everything I've learned is wrong. Because it is about a completely other way of knowing a parent before you were born. And seeing what their life looked like before you were there. Or remembering what their life looked like when you were young. And how you tell that story. But it's fascinating. And I think that we're both girls who loved our parents. And that has a big shaping influence on the stories that you wrote.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, it does.
Can I ask you a question? Do you ever finish a novel? And I'm thinking about this a lot these days, and then it's not like, well, one, you want to write it again. It's like, oh, now I've been on tour, and I've been interviewed, and I've talked to all these people, and I've been to all of these places. I would actually like to have another crack at this. That's one thing. But then also, do you ever feel like, oh, yeah, I would like to really do another novel with John Cowell? I just really enjoyed the heck out of that, and I would like to do it again. Because I find myself thinking, oh, I have this great idea for somebody telling a story to another person and the story within that story. And I keep thinking, am I allowed to do that again? Do you deal with that?
I think you are. I think you're allowed to do it as much as you want.
Yeah, but what about you? I want to know what are you?
Well, I mean, like, think about Miley Malloy's books. You know?
That's good.
Where, like,
that's good.
Miley Malloy, one of them is called The Family, Liars and Saints and a Family Daughter.
That's right.
Right. And that's exactly what she does, where she writes, these are perfect novels. And she, the first one, you read it, you're like, this is a great novel. And then you read the second one.
Years later,
and it's her writing the same thing again. It makes you totally reinvestigate what happened in the first one.
And I remember reading that second novel and thinking, are you allowed to do this? Is this okay? Like, are the novel police not going to come and get you?
Okay, wait, I'm scared because Molly put the microphone there, which means that it's almost time for all of you to start asking questions, and I literally have so much. Okay.
Okay, I'll give it really short answers. Let's
okay.
Go. Story. Everything that is good and beautiful about that story.
purpose in this job. And it was so clear, and it was only one thing.
Tell us.
I wanted to make the best possible place to work. I don't care what you read, I don't care about selling books, I don't care about women. The thing that I care about is that the people who work there are happy. And that was a real shift from the way we had operated before. I was like, happiness all around, and it has changed. It is a never-ending conga line in that bookstore. And I want to promote creativity. I said to the two managers we have, 98% of the time, if you want to do it one way and a bookseller wants to do it another way, it is not going to make a damn bit of difference. Let them do it their way. Let people be creative and supportive. Let people come to you with an idea and just say, yeah, let's give that a shot.
Between mothers and daughters in this book a bit more, and I'm curious how you think the book would have changed if it were written from the perspective of one of the daughters, or if you had included that more. I thought it was fascinating reading it as a young person and talking about it with my mother, who's your age. So
yeah. Okay. So the question. I'm gonna stand up at this point. So. The question is mothers and daughters and how the book would have been different. Well, the book would have been different because of exactly what Emma was talking about. They would only have been getting a fraction of the story, and we wouldn't have had any way to access that. Because it's you could have done it in a third-person narrative, but then it would have been an entirely different thing. So I'll tell you something super weird for those of you who have, this spoils nothing, but for those of you who have read the book, the thing that I couldn't decide up until the last minute, the last decision I made before I started writing this book, I couldn't decide if Laura was going to be the narrator or Sebastian. And it would have been a completely different book. And sometimes I think about writing that.
Yeah.
But it never the daughters. But yeah. Thanks.
Hi, Anne.
Hi.
So I went to acting school, and so I loved the part about this novel that has to do with theater, and obviously it's a lot about our town. But I was so curious about your decision to do Fool for Love as a perspective, because if you've never been to acting school, you're 19 and they make you do a bunch of crazy things, including the scene where half-siblings have a lot of sex. And I was in a program where you did that scene very often, and it caused the wild things that it causes in the book. No spoilers. So I wonder your decision about that player, your relationship.
So you know what's so interesting is people ask me about Our Town all the time, and they ask me about Chekhov all the time, and crickets for Sam Shepard and Fool for Love, which seems to me to be like the trifecta. It's such an important part of the book. And I don't know if people just haven't read Sam Shepard or it makes them uncomfortable or what it is. But going back to the mythical, fabulous Aaron Whiting, who gave me all of my information, and I said, all right, Summerstock Theater, 1988, they're doing Our Town, you know, what are they doing? And she sent me a list of plays, and one of them was Fool for Love. And immediately I was like, oh, yeah. Because what could be weirder. I never knew until Aaron told me that you go to Summerstock, you rehearse, the season opens, and then you're in Our Town at night, but you're rehearsing a separate play during the day. So what is going to give my character the maximum whiplash? Fool for Love, and then at night, put your pinafore back on, and you're going to be Emily in Our Town, while meanwhile, Cabaret is going on in the same time. It's sort of like sexually every possible scenario of what could be going on with the characters. But I love that play. And because I live in Nashville, I have seen very little live theater, and I read plays constantly. And when I come to New York, I see opera, or I go to the symphony. I almost never see theater. And so I've never seen Fool for Love.
Yeah.
It's so weird. I tried to watch the movie, and it just made me super uncomfortable.
Thank you.
But thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
So this is probably a question for both of you guys, actually. What would you say is maybe like the hardest part about your novel writing process, and what do you do to kind of overcome it?
I know the answer. Do you know the answer?
I know my answer.
Tell me your answer.
My answer is my bookstore.
Wow, that's really interesting, because you know what? And the difference is I don't actually work at the bookstore. I am the benevolent overlord. But my bookstore has made me so much more productive as an author. Because, well, it's not like your unproductiveness. But because I know what people want, and it's the same thing I want. And I know I have such a sense of what's missing and what I want to fill, and it really makes me write more. But the worst part of writing a novel is, so I started thinking about this book while I was writing The Dutch House. I wrote These Precious Days and thinking about this book. I do my research, I read all the plays, I've got everything written, and I'm thinking about this book. The worst part is when you start writing the book. And I think that there are people who are strong starters There are people who are good in the middle, there are people who are good at the end. We had Lori Moore in the bookstore, it was a couple of nights ago, it was just before I left on this part of the trip. And Lori was saying, any novelist will tell you that you get in, the beginning is easy, and then you get into the middle is dead, and the middle is a swamp, and everybody loses their way in the middle, and I wanted to go, not me. I have another friend who's such a strong starter, great in the middle, has an impossible time finishing. I have such a hard time starting. To make that transition from the book that is in my head, that is so brilliant and complete, it's the best novel in the history of literature, and then I have to write it down. And this is what happens, people. This is why you're not all writing novels, because you have it in your head, you try. It could be a novel, an essay, a short story. It could be a term paper in high school. And it's you write two pages like, this is no good at all. The thing in my head is so good. This is no good. And then you quit. But I get through that. But that's where the pain is for me. Yeah.
Amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have both of you. But I have a question for Anne. And it's actually more of a comment and a pet peeve. I've been reading some of the reviews, luckily after I read the book.
Yeah.
Because there's a spoiler, in my opinion, in some of the reviews that has to do with, I want to tell people, don't read the reviews.
We know what it has to do with, yes.
Do you know what it has to do
yes.
with? And if it made you as angry as it made me.
No, it didn't make me angry at all because I didn't read them. and I don't not read reviews because I'm sensitive, because actually I'm about the most insensitive person in the world. Reading reviews is unbelievably boring if you have written the book. The good reviews are as weird and boring as the bad reviews. And so many things that are written about my work are about me as a person and how nice I am. The word on the street, friends, I'm nice. Why tie yourself in knots? The reviews come out, I can't do anything about it. That's it.
So you've already saying that fact and fiction are not the same. You've already mentioned that the grandmother was based off of your grandmother, and Nelson probably named after your grandmother.
Yeah.
And
did you know that?
You wrote about it in your essay about happy marriage.
Okay. I haven't read that. Okay.
But are there any other tidbits also other than your husband that have weaved their way into Tom Lake of your personal life?
You know, that's such a weird question.
I'll put myself.
Probably what everybody wants to know anyway. You know, my impulse is to say, no, it's fiction, I made it up. Probably if we did some kind of round where you raised your hand and said, yeah, but what about X? I would be like, oh, well, that's because of this. Like the pear trees. You know, like the scary pear trees. Probably just about everything, even though it's fiction, even though I've never acted, I've never been a mother, I've never worked on a cherry orchard, there are little glimmers of my life all over the place. And I'm trying to think, you know, it's like Peter Duke is every single guy I dated in my 20s. And I went to graduate school at the University of Iowa. I have an MFA. And the poets, oh my God. Oh my God. They rolled their own cigarettes. They read Stanley Kunitz. They memorized Yeats. They drank, and sometimes they were lonely when they drank late at night. And you could find them outside of the bar at 1 in the morning smoking as hand rolled cigarettes. And they suffered so much. I believe that I could alleviate their suffering. be convinced that poets were really that hot.
Sister, and what stuck with me throughout the whole book is how you created such like distinct, realistic, and complex characters for the sisters in the book.
Thank you. So how did I complete complex, realistic sister relationships? I have a sister, and I have a lot of stepsisters, and I have a lot of sisterly friends, and you just listen. You don't have to have an experience. You just have to listen to other people's experiences. People talk all the time. It's so fascinating. So to just be interested in other people and their dynamics and the way sisters hate each other at certain times of their lives and then double back around. Also, my sister was something of an Emily. My sister was and then now she's the good sister. Now she's the one that everybody likes best. We gave her the time of day when we were kids. And now she's the favorite. So that's everything, like letting your characters change in their relationship. That's a lot of fun.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Anne. My name is Cricket. I actually met you before in Maplewood, New Jersey.
Hi, Cricket.
Hi, Anne.
I remember this, and I bet I know what you're going to ask me.
I'm actually going to ask you a different question.
The answer, which I, you know, again, this is what is booked for, but one long psychotherapy session. Yes, Cricket, it's you.
Oh, my goodness. Well,
yes.
I just wanted to. So, I'll try
wow.
to. I'll try to tell the story. Anne spoke about the Dutch House at in Maplewood, New Jersey, where I live, which is a great town with a great independent bookstore.
Okay, say it louder or get into the microphone.
Oh, sorry. So Anne was doing a book tour for Dutch House, and there's an incredible independent bookstore in the town where I live in Maplewood, New Jersey, just 20 miles outside of New York, called Words. And she gave an unbelievable talk, and then we all lined up to get our books signed.
Pre-COVID.
And I think it was like January even. My name is Cricket, and I had it on a post-it. And when Anne was signing the book, she looked straight into my eyes and said, I'm gonna put a cricket in my next book. And I was like, that's amazing. I couldn't even breathe, I couldn't talk. And then you wrote a very beautiful note about how much you liked the name. And then Tom Lake came out, and I have read all your books, and so I was going to go get it, read some reviews, and I saw that there was Laura and Duke and Maisie and Nell and Emily, which obviously I had no expectations around, but here we are. So my sister called me because she had started to listen to the audio book, and she was in chapter 15, 14, she said, oh my God, Cricket is in the book. So Cricket is Laura's pet name that Duke calls her.
And here's another interesting thing that nobody has noticed at all. Duke never once says Laura's name. He calls her Emily, or he calls her Cricket. He never calls her Laura.
I didn't notice that.
No
I mean,
one, no one. No one has noticed that. But you know what's so strange is I had those moments, and honestly, I did not remember that conversation until you came up. But it goes into the compost heap of my brain. And I remember one night somebody coming up to me in a signing line, and this must have been when I was on tour for Run, And this woman came up and she said, you know what? I would like to see a deaf person in a novel that wasn't about deafness. I would just like there to be a deaf person and nobody's talking about the fact that they're deaf. And I was like, yeah, I can do that. And so instead of other, there's a character of Easter because somebody said, yes, you know, put a deaf person named Cricket in your novel and then you would just get the whole thing done.
No, it was remarkable, and now I, like, trust anything you say. Like, Anne Patchett is good on her word.
One last question before you go. What's your name on your birth certificate?
Juliet.
Oh, that's lovely, too.
Two T's and an E. And I run, like, coincidentally, obviously, Anne had, I grew up in a summer stock theater, so I was going to ask you, and you've answered this in some ways over the night, like, how, I mean, you captured the relationships and the energy, and I know you had this researcher from Michigan.
I can answer this question before you finish saying yes,
okay.
Because I went to writer's colonies. Did you?
No.
Oh, Yaddo, McDowell, any of those places that are basically summer camps for adults where you go for a limited period of time and have sex with people that you didn't mean to.
Yeah, that's it.
That's, I just tapped that. It's not sort of like you can't do poets, you also can't do artist colonies in books. So you just turn it into summer stock theater. And all the theater people I know are like, how did you know?
I mean, this is crazy.
It's
yeah.
Like, because I went to Yaddo and we got, and that's what we did.
All the time we have, but what a gorgeous note to end on. Thank you all.
Oh wait, I'm going to tell you something before we go. Go out and buy a book called Do Tell by Lindsay Lynch. This is my raison d'etre for book tour. Lindsay is our buyer of Parnassus. This is her first novel, and in the same way that it's very important to support your local independent bookstores, it's really important to take a chance on first-time novelists. You're always going to read the Anna Straub, you're always going to read the Anna Patchett. Go outside your comfort zone, and it's a terrific book about the golden age of Hollywood and has one of the best endings ever. Thank you.
What's the line?
What's the line?
What's the line?
What's the line?